really complete, garbage is out there, it's not being taken care of. The rats that are out there, it's not being taken care of. The doors that are not locked properly, so we feel safe. My building is three buildings in one, and I'm afraid, and when the sun goes down, the rats come out, and it looks like rock will fall, because they have to fall on the ground. Okay? And it's so many rats, and it's slab on here.
Wow.
Why don't we have these buildings here? They don't have the opportunity to get in a container where you won't have to deal with the rats, other squirrels going in the garbage, and then we can have you feel safe. We also have to make sure we're walking in here, and I'm really not in here, and we state the fact that there's no hookups in here. We're infested with that too, okay? We need help over here. We need help with this landlord that's not acting like
let me just say this. First of all, we have different kinds of meetings. I don't know if anybody here has gone to a community board or know what a community board really does. But the community board is really in charge of things like that. Except for the danger. Now, I can tell you this. Jeremy Warnicki, the district manager, and Tony Vitaliano are looking into this.
Chairman.
I can tell you, the chairman of the board, they're looking into what's happening here in this complex. Also, Richie Torres, councilman, and
Assemblyman Mark Tonak. Mark Tonak was able to secure this room. Now, he's looking into this. And Mark has a history. He has a background in real estate. In a big way. So he's looking into this and he's looking into that. Now we've got these elected officials, we've got the community board, and they're both actively working on this. And we'd love to get this room back to you. We'd also like to find the chairs. But these are issues, really, that belong in the community board. Again, the community board is working on this. Mark Jonah is working on this. And Ricky Torres is working on this. The first time that everybody has gone to bat for this. And we will get some results. Okay. So you know you can get in touch with us and find out what kind of progress we're making.
I don't know whether you guys know that I lost this son in 2005. I'm mother's against on driving. And every year I get up to speak about that. And I find that it's appalling that people are still working on the phone every day, but we're driving in Texas.
They're not drinking.
They can't cut down the number, and when you look up, you're running over somebody over a wall. This has to stop. It really has to stop. And I'm offended by this UPS car the other day. I couldn't get his license plate number. I was out cleaning pet rescue. And he missed me like this much. And he must have been playing with his phone. I wish I'd got his number. There's another thing that I'd like to touch on today. Relating to something that I saw online that really hit home. There's a new drink app called Crush Community Drinks. It sells for $10 online. And just think for a minute that if you have a 12-year-old or a 9-year-old, decide to get on a computer and work it yourself, and they think that the food and drink, well, surprise, surprise, is filled with all kinds of different alcohol. And when you say what it was, it's illegal and it's water. And so far as I know, it's contaminated. 19 years old, firing baseball player, and he was still playing driver, who was 17 years old 9 years ago. So we still have to work on this thing. Speed, guts, dealt. He was going 100 miles an hour, and he hit a tree at Orchard Beach and fell off.
Thank you,
just quick thing I'd like to say, that due to pet rescue, it is a crime to abuse and kill an animal. I also work with another rescuer who will remain nameless with the investigation going on. But we think that there should be a $5,000 fine for animal abuse and a Class E felony.
Thank you, Mel.
I just want to ask about the incident on May 13th at 3 p.m. on the corner of Hunt Avenue and Sagamore Street. A Muslim woman was knocked, and by a young male. Did they ever find him? The detectives came down and questioned the neighbors. And they came to me too, and why didn't I hear anything? And I had an alibi, I was up in the room. But I said, of course I would have, you know, called or run out there, you know, would say hello to all the people from the house and the building and everything, there's no problem. But was there any follow-up on that?
There's, I spoke earlier about 43, that's one block away from Pattern 43. The cell phone in that case, like in the other three cases, was the target of what the perpetrator wanted to take. The difference was that with a single male black by himself, he approached her from behind. She never got a look. He put her into a chokehold and he beat her on her face until she dropped the cell phone. We do have one very good eyewitness to that. He was on the front of his porch sweeping. He was in shock and awe, I think, when he saw it. He didn't know how to react right away, but he did go to her for a call 911. We have not made an apprehension on that. What we are doing, increase enforcement down there. We have a group of people that we know may be doing this, but the problem is that our witness can't ID. She cannot ID. He approached from behind, he's there. Our witness sees the incident, but just can't see the face.
She was on the cell phone.
She was on the cell phone.
She was walking.
Correct. Yeah. And going to Nancy's point before, with it, she spoke about motor vehicles and people using their electronic devices. It is a major cause of our accidents. It's distraction. But in the same content, that same distraction is the same reason why our pedestrians are getting hit. Because they're too busy. I see it, they come off the subway, the first thing everybody does, because they're afraid to show it, is they go right to the phone. And what are they doing? They pay attention and walk across the street and they get hit.